snap to Richardson, option right, pitch to Lewis, down at the 5-yard line by Mark Berry.
I just told him that we were going to do everything, and I got to thinking about all the different things we need to do, and I said, you know, really, it's just whatever it takes, that's what we're going to do, and it just kind of caught on with the players, you know.
No matter what happens in the football game, we're going to do whatever it takes to come out with the victory, and that's the whole attitude. So if it means going, watching a lot of film, if it means working hard in practice and almost killing yourself, then that's whatever it takes to get this team a championship.
Football's mainly a game of attitude, and I feel that the senior leadership and the whole feeling on the team that we can't be beat. You have to believe that you can't be beat, and that's what's made the difference this year.
Gardner hands it to Wilson, coming left, knocked hard at the 1-yard line, bangs to the goal line, touchdown Texas.
You know, we've had a lot of senior leadership this year, and a lot of people, and everybody knows what we can do, and we just have to do it.
Playing for the national championship is what we came here to do. When we were seniors, when we were freshmen, we came here to play for the national championship, to wear that Cotton Bowl ring, to wear a national championship ring, and to have all the excitement and the frills that go along with that.
Harry Cash splits to the right. Gardner's going to throw a fade to Cash. He caught it. It's a touchdown, Texas.
For the 1990 Texas Longhorns, the quest for the Cotton Bowl began at 6:30 a.m. on a cold February morning. Each day on the darkened Memorial Stadium turf came the rhythmic sounds of a football team committed to returning the Southwest Conference Championship to the 40 acres.
I think when it started, I don't know how many of them were that fond of it, but then they got where they really liked it, because then you get your practice in the morning early, and then you're off the rest of the day. But it really came more from the seniors wanting to do it than anyone else.
Getting up at 6 o'clock in the morning is primarily doing whatever it takes to better yourself as an athlete and to better this team.
In completing their mission to do whatever it takes, the Longhorns compiled a 10-1 record at a shot at the national title. Along the way, David McWilliams and his troops captured the hearts and souls of fans everywhere with a style that was all guts and determination. A perfect blend of dynamic youth and senior leadership provided the mixture for one of the finest Texas teams in years. The Horns started strong with the 17-13 season opening victory at Penn State and finished the regular season with a 28-27 thriller over arch rival Texas A&M to close out a remarkable campaign.
So this fall when we started, we were prepared. We didn't add or take out a lot of things, and the players knew what we were trying to do offensively and defensively.
Reflecting on this championship season is an exercise in the sheer will of the coaches and players. A team that understood the meaning of commitment, sacrifice, and the significance of a phrase by which they lived an entire season.
For me, I know when I'm playing in a game and it's a crucial situation, I have it written down on my arm, on my tape, for every game. I look at it when I'm tired and hurt and I can't do anything else. I look down and I say, man, whatever it takes, I got to do whatever it takes. And I think that pretty much speaks for all the other players, too. I mean, everybody, like I said, when the game's on the line, everybody's putting out more than they ever have. And it's just an emotional thing. Everybody can feel it's in the atmosphere, and we can feel it every single game, no matter who we're playing.
The Horns opened the season in front of a national television audience against legendary coach Joe Paterno and the Penn State Nittany Lions. Texas had many questions to answer following a disappointing 5-6 season. But with 18 starters back and the emergence of several young stars, Longhorn fans looked to the new decade with unbridled optimism. But that excitement quickly gave way to absolute terror on the game's opening kickoff. Texas quickly fell behind, but this was a team that would later become known as one of the great come-from-behind teams in Longhorn history. Untested kicker Michael Pollock provided all the first half points as the Longhorns entered the locker room at halftime trailing 7-6.
We went up there and in front of 86,000 people in a hostile environment and came out with a win.
And I think that had a lot to do with setting the stage for the rest of the season.
Not to be outdone, the Longhorns returned the Penn State favor with some special teams wizardry of their own to open the second half.
High, and Walker will take it at the 6 and bring it up to the 15, 20, 25. Adrian Walker to the 40. Amanda beat to midfield. A cut on the kicker to the 40. To the 30. To the sideline to the 20. To the 10. Hurdles a man to the 6-yard line.
Texas quickly jumped out to a 17-7 lead. Only to have it slip away as the game progressed. Fittingly, the game hinged on one final desperation play.
Sacco with 4, back to throw with 3, with 2, with 1. He throws it up for grabs in the end zone. It's incomplete, and the game is over, and Texas wins.
We believe that we could win it all after Penn State. I mean, we knew that Penn State was a, you know, very good ball club, and to go up there and beat them at home was definitely a major accomplishment, and we were excited and pleased with that.
The 17-13 win put the Horns at 1-0, but the real significance lay deeper. David McWilliams' club was giving an indication of the memorable season that was ahead. The Longhorns returned home to face highly rated Colorado. Bill McCartney's Buffaloes returned many of the same players from a squad that had finished an Orange Bowl victory away from a national title in 1989. Before a packed Memorial Stadium crowd, the Horns and the Buffs went toe-to-toe in a 60-minute battle royal. Brian Jones's recovery of a Darian Hagan fumble helped Texas take an early 7-0 lead. A Michael Pollock field goal closed the gap to 14-13 by halftime as momentum began to shift in Texas' favor. With Texas clinging to a 19-14 lead, the unbelievable happened.
Kickoff by Pollock. He hit the top of the ball, and it's like an onside, and scrambling loose, and Texas may have fallen on it. Oh, they did. Unbelievable. If that's not Texas tonight, I give up.
When Texas had recovered, it looked as if the Horns were ready to spring the upset. Behind the dazzling play of quarterback Darian Hagan and the powerful running of Eric Bieniemy, the seasoned Buffaloes reeled off 15 unanswered fourth quarter points to escape Austin with a hard-fought 29-22 win.
After the game, Stanley Richards said, let this feel how this feels like, and let's not have this feeling ever again.
With a week off to reflect, it was time to ponder the remaining season. At 1-1, Texas was unranked and unnoticed by the college football world. But all the elements were in place for a Longhorn stampede. The first step to the Cotton Bowl would be taken against a much improved Rice team. An Owl team with revenge on its mind after losing a 31-30 heartbreaker to Texas a year earlier in Austin. But David McWilliams and his players answered the challenge with an outstanding defensive effort. It was a game they would dominate from start to finish. The Horns would capitalize on an early special teams mistake by the Owls. Eric Henley's fumbled punt opened the door for Texas. The Longhorns jumped to a quick 7-0 lead, a lead they would never relinquish. Four Michael Pollock field goals and a stifling Longhorn defense clipped the Owls 26-10.
I remember the play against Rice when they were trying to get back in the ball game on the goal line. We turned the ball over to them, and I hit Hollis, and he fumbled the ball.
Slot right, Cobb motion right. Hollis, quarterback sneak to the 1, and the ball's out. It's rolling around at the 3. Oh, wait, it is a fumble recovery for Texas.
As Texas took its first step toward its ultimate goal, the Cotton Bowl. And the Cotton Bowl it was. But this time, the Horns were not representing the Southwest Conference. Instead, they were carrying the flag of the entire state into that annual rumble they call Texas OU. Many observers felt it would be difficult to match the 27-24 thriller of 1989. But the 1990 Texas-Oklahoma grudge match provided drama all its own. Off to a 5-0 start, Oklahoma was dominating opponents like the Sooner teams of old. Meanwhile, Texas, unranked going into the game, envisioned an opportunity to thrust itself back into the national spotlight. The Sooners controlled the game early with strong runs up the middle. But Texas held, and OU was forced to settle for three. Texas rebounded behind a swing pass to running back Chris Samuels for a long gainer. With the Longhorns at the Oklahoma 8, it was time for Texas to go to an old standby, the alley-oop pass to tight end Kerry Cash. The Gardere to Cash connection gave Texas a 7-3 lead as the first quarter came to a close. But the Sooners retook the lead with a touchdown burst up the middle. Oklahoma threatened again, marching inside the Texas 10. But the UT defense rose to the occasion. Linebacker Anthony Curl stripped Sooner quarterback K.O. Gundy of the ball, and Oscar Giles recovered, leaving the Horns down 10-7 at the half. With time running out in the third quarter, OU increased its lead to 13-7 on place kicker R.D. Lasher's second field goal of the day. Texas battled back, only to be frustrated by turnovers on consecutive fourth quarter drives. With time becoming a factor, the Longhorns needed a spark. That spark came in the form of a 6'2", 215-pound bowling ball they called Butch. Running back Butch Hadnock, a true freshman from Kirbyville, ignited the Texas offense with spectacular runs on two consecutive plays. But the Horns stalled on three attempts deep inside Sooner territory, leaving them with 4th and 7 from the OU 8-yard line. David McWilliams called timeout, and the stage was set.
I think the most important play is probably the drive against Oklahoma. It happened to be 2 years in a row, but I think last play to Keith Cash for the touchdown to win that game, I think that was really important.
As far as the 91-yard drive, certainly that was a big series. Probably the running of Butch Hadnott in that particular series I felt like was a catalyst when Butch came out and on the very first play. Not only did he make some yards, he ran over some people and he ran through some people, and I think that really fired our team up.
Gardner back to throw. Blitz coming. Throws it over the middle. It's caught at the goal line. It's a touchdown for Keith Cash.
The Gardner to Keith Cash touchdown pass sent the Cotton Bowl Stadium crowd into a frenzy as the Horns took a 14-13 lead with just 2 minutes left in the game. But the Sooners were far from finished. Freshman K.O. Gundy guided OU on an impressive drive to position the Sooners for a possible game-winning field goal. Kicker R.D. Lasher hurried onto the field to attempt a 47-yarder as the clock was winding down.
The ball is spotted at the 37, 47 yards, 6-5. The kick is on the way. The kick is wide to the left with 1 second. The gun sounds. The game is over. The Longhorns beat Oklahoma again.
For the second year in a row, Texas had defeated Oklahoma in the game's waning moments. But in this 83-year-old Texas-OU rivalry, fans have come to expect great games from great teams. Over the previous 6 years, an alarming trend had developed in the Texas-Arkansas series. Since 1984, the home team had not won the game. Obviously, the two-time defending Southwest Conference champions again had upset in their minds when they stepped onto the Memorial Stadium turf. Texas opened the scoring with a Peter Gardere strike to tight end Kerry Cash, giving Texas a 7-0 lead midway through the first quarter. But Arkansas answered quickly on a Quinn Grovey to Tracy Caldwell pass to knock the score at 7-7. The Razorbacks kept it close heading into the final period, but they would soon discover what other teams were quickly learning. Texas was an explosive fourth quarter team. Running back Adrian Walker opened the quarter with a touchdown run. Butch Hadnott carried Razorback defenders into the end zone to make the score 34-17. Backup quarterback Jimmy Saxton also got in on the act, hitting wide receiver Derek Duke on a 6-yard fade route. Patrick Wilson plowed over from the one as Texas completed the route 49-17. When the dust settled, the Longhorns had scored 4 fourth-quarter touchdowns and a 2-point conversion. Suddenly, Texas was being mentioned as a championship contender. But the SMU Mustangs and their run-and-shoot offense provided Texas with a unique problem: defending a pure passing offense for the first time all season. In 1989, Texas ranked 6th in the conference in pass defense, but had yet to be seriously tested in 1990. But the Longhorn defense responded like it had all year. When the big play was needed, the Texas D provided it. The front four of Tommy Jeter, James Patton, Oscar Giles, and Shane Dronette pounded SMU quarterback Mike Romo all day. The Pony air attack never got off the ground. Through three quarters, the Horns were cruising with a 24-0 lead. But when the final period came around, the Horns once again turned up the heat. Just like the week before, the Texas offense exploded, scoring 4 fourth-quarter touchdowns. One of them was a Butch Hadnott special. The bruising back left defenders scattered in his path on a 64-yard burst that finished the Ponies. Texas proceeded to win 52-10 and silenced many questions about the Longhorns' ability to stop the pass. At 6-1, the Longhorns were quickly gaining national respect. Talk of a Texas-Houston matchup was already being heard. But Texas had one difficult task to manage before the war with the Cougars: win in Lubbock against Texas Tech. They say West Texas weather can change with the blink of an eye. Well, so can the outcome of a football game. As many a coach will tell you, you don't play in Lubbock, you survive it. With winds gusting to 30 miles per hour and temperatures hovering in the 40s, the Longhorns hope to do just that. Texas Tech opened the game with the unthinkable, going directly into the gale force wind.
As the Red Raiders come out in their 3-wide receiver set on 3rd and 9, Gill back to throw. Here's a blitz. He throws it deep. He's got a man. It's caught at the 50. And this is going to be Rodney Blackshear all the way.
Tech had scored in just 44 seconds, and David McWilliams and his staff realized there was no looking ahead to the showdown with Houston. They had all they could handle right there in Lubbock. But the Horns hung tough and took a 20-10 lead into the fourth quarter. A Boone Powell interception returned for a touchdown.
Intercepted by Boone Powell, 25-20, 15-10, touchdown, Texas.
Well, it was the least thing I expected. You know, he just kind of threw it right to me, and I caught the ball. And from then on, it was just kind of like a dream. It was kind of like slow motion. I think Brian got a good block for me down there, and I just took it in the end zone. After that, I really don't remember what happened.
A Shane Dronette blocked field goal. And two quarterback sacks later, and the Longhorns escaped Lubbock with an impressive 41-22 win over the Red Raiders.
I think it was very important that our defense started to really gel. They were playing the running game well all year, but we started facing some teams that really throw the football, and we started getting good pass rush by our linemen, and that carried us through those three games right in that area. But more importantly than anything was the mental aspect that we were ready each particular ball game. The other thing that happened in those three games, I mean, consistently, was the second half. I mean, fourth quarter, we scored 28 points in the Arkansas game in the fourth quarter. We scored, I think, 21 points against SMU. We scored 21 against Texas Tech, all in the fourth quarter. And that makes you feel good as a coach to know that you're keeping that intensity up, and goes back to what I said about Penn State and Colorado, that we're going to close out strong in the second half and especially the fourth quarter.
Now Texas was ready for the game everyone had been waiting for. The electricity of big-time college football filled the cool Austin air on this November night. The third-ranked Houston Cougars were armed with a Heisman candidate at quarterback, a perennial 1,000-yard rusher at running back, speed to burn at the receiver positions, and the desire to show a national television audience that Houston Cougar football was for real. All the Texas Longhorns had was a will to win and a deafening Memorial Stadium crowd behind them. The Cougars had outscored Texas 173-64 over the previous three seasons. So how would the Horns stop the vaunted Houston run-and-shoot attack this time?
You know, going into the game, there was a lot of criticism from the press and the media about whether you could play the style of defense that we play against a run-and-shoot. And I think it became a challenge to our team to go out and prove that we could play our defense, our base defense, without any basic changes, and play it well enough to beat one of the top passing teams in the history of football.
Defensively, the Horns were intimidating. Houston quarterback David Klingler was intercepted five times. And hurried countless other passes. The Texas secondary, led by free safety Stanley Richard, blanketed Cougar receivers all night long. The Longhorn front seven shut down Houston's all-everything running back, Chuck Weatherspoon, as the Spoon was given a large dose of James Patton, Oscar Giles, Brian Jones, Shane Dronette, and Anthony Curl. Offensively, the show was stolen by that freshman running back who pounded would-be tacklers as if they did not exist. Butch Hadnott electrified the sellout crowd with run after run as he went over, around, and through Houston defenders on his way to 143 yards rushing.
Gardner, handoff, Hadnott behind a Johnson block, 15, 10, carrying them to the 5, to the 3. Goodness, what a run by Hadnott.
When the final gun sounded, Texas had defeated the Cougars 45-24 and served notice that Texas Longhorn football was again a force to be reckoned with.
They come into the ball game ranked number 3, and we were like 12 or so, and we just completely dominate them. And I think that's kind of scares a little bit. You know, we're a little bit better than we thought we were, you know, and we've just took it all in stride and kept improving each week.
When they knew that defensively, hey, we're going to go out, make the adjustments that you have to make against a run-and-shoot team, but don't change anything. And players recognize those things. They know when you have confidence in them. And so I think that's a tribute to Leon Fuller and the defensive coaches. And then, of course, the rest of it is just is what I'd say would be history in terms of that football game, starting with the crowd that we had and the enthusiasm there. And the way our offense exploded, because defensively we played very well, but Houston is able to score very quickly. Our offense took the football, and I tell you, they scored, and that was one of the goals. Let's try to put some points on the board on every single possession. And there weren't many in that game that we didn't get some points out of.
A letdown was expected when Texas traveled to Fort Worth to take on the resurgent TCU Horned Frogs. The Horns started slowly, fighting sluggishness and a fired-up Horned Frog team. But Texas hung on long enough to get a much-needed fourth-quarter wake-up call. Clinging to a 17-10 lead, Texas looked to Butch Hadnott to provide the needed lift.
Toss left, short side, Hadnott down the sideline, 30, 20, and forced out of bounds by Gray Evans at the TCU 15-yard line.
Hadnott responded with two big runs. Peter Gardier then went to the air, making it 24-10.
Gardier, bootleg right, looking left, looking for the escape. No one there. He runs right, throws it in the end zone. It's caught for a touchdown by Keith Cash, who stole it from his brother, Kerry.
The Longhorns went on to score two more touchdowns in the final period.
Bootleg left, Gardier. Here comes the pressure, throwing deep for Davis. Can he catch it at the 10? In for the touchdown, Texas.
Finishing the route 38-10 and putting themselves in a position to lock up the Cotton Bowl berth. Texas faced the enviable task of only needing to win one of its remaining two games to clinch the Southwest Conference title. Enviable, that is, until you consider they would need to win in Waco, a place where Texas had not won in its last seven trips, at a place where the Horns had won just once in 18 years. Baylor took the win and jumped to an early 10-0 lead. But Texas closed the first half with a 56-yard Michael Pollock field goal to take the Horns into the locker room trailing 10-3. With the wind at its back, Texas took the ball and drove into Baylor territory. Then, as so many times before, offensive coordinator Glenn Amity called on Hadnott to deliver the big play.
We want to be as balanced as we possibly can, and because when you get in big games, you want to be able to break keys. You're going to run all the time, or you're going to throw all the time. Well, we want to balance up. Butch had not answered the question. He gave us the big back who can run inside and pound you and make things happen, which our offensive linemen kind of like.
Leading 20-13 early in the fourth quarter, Texas began what would be the drive for the Cotton Bowl. A drive that typified this Longhorn team in so many ways. The Horns chewed precious time off the clock as they marched downfield. Facing fourth and one inside Baylor territory, Texas would once again rely on its fourth quarter charm.
Handoff, Adrian Walker over the top for a first down to the 30-yard line.
Michael Pollock then nailed the door shut on Baylor, and Texas had its first victory in Waco in 8 years and its first Southwest Conference title in 7 years. With the Cotton Bowl berth and a number 5 national ranking in hand, Texas had every right to be complacent. The championship dream was fulfilled, and everything had finally fallen into place. Everything, that is, except a win over the Aggies of Texas A&M. The Horns had just one streak left to break, the Aggies' 6-year domination of Texas. Again, Texas spotted the visitors a lead as the Aggies jumped ahead 14-0. But the Horns would never say die, With Butch Hadnott out of the lineup nursing a hand injury, Texas would have to find a new offensive spark. This time, the spark was provided by quarterback Peter Gardere, who ran for two touchdowns and passed for another in a gutty performance on this afternoon. Texas responded with 14 second quarter points. But the talented Aggies rallied. Behind Darren Lewis's 150 yards and three touchdowns, A&M continued to threaten. With Texas leading 28-21, Aggie quarterback Bucky Richardson called his own number on a 4th and 4 from the Texas 32. The Aggies elected to go for the two-point conversion with 3 minutes 46 seconds left in the game.
Pitch to Lewis, down to the 5-yard line by Mark Berry. And the two-point conversion is turned aside.
One last time, Texas answered the bell. With a 28-27 victory, Texas had completed a quest few had given them any hope of achieving. But for this Texas team, nothing seemed impossible. For this was a team with a plan to do whatever it takes.
It just seemed to fit when I was thinking about this year, talking to the players about what we were going to do and what we needed to do, and also to the coaches. And I just told them that we were going to do everything. And I got to thinking about all the different things we need to do. And I said, you know, really, it's just whatever it takes. That's what we're going to do.